Good morning, Crazy Faith. Thank you for being here with us today. Today is another day that God has allowed us to take a breath and to breathe in the wonder of His majestic works, so we praise God for this day. We pray a special prayer for those watching with us today that God continues to work in your lives. Y'all, please get vaccinated. The hospital system in Mississippi is literally failing. They are having to turn away patients because the units are filled to the max with majority unvaccinated COVID patients. You don't want your loved one to have to go to the hospital, but they don't have any room. This decision not only affects you, but so many others, so please, y'all, do your part. For anyone watching or for anyone in your lives who is struggling this week, we want you all to know that God's got it. God hears you, and He is wrapping His arms around you. Keep holding on, because a change is coming, and a mighty move of God is on the way. Take comfort in His presence. Now let's get our praise on, y'all. Help us to praise His name.
Every praise is to our God. Every A joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness, come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, she is God. It is God that has made us, and not we ourselves. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. So enter into his gates with thanksgiving and enter into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto God and bless God's holy name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endures to all generations. Praise ye the Lord.
And now we praise God with our hands and voices, and we pray the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. When his disciples asked him, Lord, how do you pray? And he answered, you pray like this.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy
Today I will be reading from Amos chapter 6 verses 1 through 7 from the New International Version. Woe to you who are complacent in Zion, and to you who feel secure on Mount Samaria, you notable men of the foremost nation, to whom the people of Israel come. Go to Calneh and look at it. Go from there to the great Hamath, and then go down to Gath in Philistia. Are they better off than your two kingdoms? Is their land larger than yours? You put off the day of disaster and bring near a reign of terror. You lie on beds adorned with ivy and lounge in your couches. You dine on choice lambs and fattened calves. You strum away on your harps like David and improvise on musical instruments. You drink wine by the bowlful and use the finest lotions, but you do not grieve over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore, you will be among the first to go into exile. Your feasting and lounging will end. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, the reading, and the understanding of his holy word.
On this day, just join with us in prayer. Almighty and most merciful God, we are glad. We are glad. We are honored. We feel blessed that we made it from last Sunday to this Sunday. We ask you now, God, to be a presence in this worship experience. Someone may need to hear what's going to be talked about today. Someone may not know what he or she needs to hear. And hopefully, God, something in this message will satisfy that place in them where they need to hear a word from you. We know that if you are not in the midst of this worship service, there is no worship. So, Holy Spirit, come by here, rest, rule, and abide with us in the name of Jesus the Christ. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
So we got to another week. The pandemic is still raging, so I'm still going to push that you guys please get the vaccine. It's about saving ourselves and saving our communities, and we really have to do that. So I'm going to ask you to pray with me on the subject when nobody will listen to you. When nobody will listen to you. I don't know about for you, but for me, it's a very frustrating thing when people will not listen, when they're not listening. You're trying your best to get a point across and people will not listen. It is so frustrating. You can actually hear somebody and not be listening. Did you know that? We hear everything. We listen to very little. The formal or a formal definition of listening is receiving language through the ears, receiving language through the ears. Listening means one is identifying the sounds being heard and is processing them into words and sentences. In other words, if you're not processing what's being said into words and sentences, if you're not playing back what was said to you so that you can understand it, you're not listening. Listening requires focus and attention, and it requires respect for the person who is sending out the language. Listening means we invest some of us, some of ourselves into the spirit of the one who was talking because they matter. People's voices, people's opinions, people's feelings, they matter. And so we invest in that. We don't ignore him or her, but we are actually inclining our ear toward whomever is speaking and whatever is being said. We're not ignoring them. We're not ignoring. We are trying to put together words and sentences so that we can understand what it is they are saying, not what we think they are saying or not what we want them to be saying. So when a person is trying to communicate with you and you are not listening, it becomes very frustrating and it causes all types of problems. So we already know that we hear words. I've been in arguments with people before when I was married and they'd say, you hear my words, but you're not listening. And my ex-husband would look at me like I was crazy, but there is a difference. There really is a difference. And I know growing up, I all of us did this thing. We heard lyrics of a song. This is so funny to me because we listen, we think we're listening to music, but we're really not because we put our own words in to the songs. And it's years later after we've been singing a song wrong for that many years that we realize, oh shoot, that's what they were saying. I remember my brother, he's my little brother, Bruce. And we used to sing in our house, This Old Man, and Bruce, we called him Brucey. Brucey would sing Grits, G-R-I-T-S, Grits Old Man. He sang that until he was 22, I promise you. We sing words because we don't listen to them. We get into the beat and, you know, maybe the sound of a person's voice, but we don't really hone in on what they're actually saying. So we all do that. And I'll bet we all have a bevy of songs, a collection of songs that we sang growing up with the absolute wrong lyrics. We heard the music and we heard the sound of the voices, but we did not take the time to really receive the language that was being given. We don't. Even if we get the words, I remember a song called Whip Appeal. You know, we just walk around singing it, but we needed to stop and listen to those lyrics and see what they were saying. We don't often do that. We don't take time to process the sounds, and we just go along our merry way singing wrong things. So why is it that we don't listen? We don't even listen to the music that we like, but why is it that we don't listen to each other? Why do we not listen in general? Is it because we are in a hurry? Are we lazy? Are we stubborn and belligerent? Is it all of that? Is it? I remember thinking that kids not listening to parents is an age-old problem. Anybody who has kids, especially teenagers, know exactly what I'm talking about. But it doesn't have to be a teen. It can be a toddler who is beginning to understand the wonders of this world. And the toddler will walk around and touch things that he or she is not supposed to touch. And you tell them not to do it, but they don't listen. So we have to learn by experience, right? So I was thinking about how kids don't listen to parents, but parents not listening to their children is an equally as common a problem. We parents too often tend to disregard the children as though they were not human beings with feelings and opinions and needs, with minds of their own. How many times have we missed something that one of our children has tried to share with us? How many times have we absolutely refused to listen to their reasons for some of the things that they're doing? Now, a lot of those reasons may be off the wall, but some of them are really, really important, and we don't listen. And we push our kids away from us because we will not listen. How many times have we ignored what they've tried to share with us, that something is really seriously wrong in their lives? Maybe it's they're being bullied or sexually molested or treated poorly or unfairly by a teacher. How many times have we refused to listen to their dreams because we are so into making our children into what we want them to be? So we don't listen to them. We don't watch their body language. We don't watch their eyes. We don't hear even the sounds of their voices because we want them to be what we want them to be. We don't own them. We don't own them. We are caretakers. We are stewards, but we don't listen. We don't listen to their dreams, and we have forced our desires on them because we think we have the authority to do it. And so we do it and we call it love, but that is not love. Not listening to our kids and then making them do what we want them to do is control. And there's a big difference between love and control. One does not have to love somebody to control. Obviously, we see that in what's going on in our world today. And you might have seen it in your house. You can be a control freak and not love a kid, period. Or a control freak and not love your mate or your mom or your dad. Control and love are two different things. But what happens, though, so many kids are controlled. They're just controlled. And they grow up into frustrated and angry adults because whatever it was that they needed to be heard when they were little, whatever they needed to be considered, whatever thing they needed some respect on as a child never happened. And that does something in your insides, no matter how young you are. You want to be heard. You want to be listened to. You want to be understood. And when that doesn't happen, kids grow up thinking and believing that no person in authority will listen. And they fight against, many times, they fight against authority. Many times, married people or couples don't listen to each other. And I always ask couples when they come for counseling, do you want to be married or do you want to be right? You can be right. You can fight this out if you want. You can be right, but you will not be married. We don't listen to people, to each other, and in our relationships. We talk past each other and we talk at each other, but we very rarely talk to each other and stop to take the time to listen. Remember, I have said that when you're talking to God, we talk to God and we talk and we listen for God. That listening is not just a single thing. It has these two functions. You listen to and you listen for. And when we are in relationships, we are so interested in being right that we get into these shouting matches or even, you know, just speech patterns where we're overtaking the other one and nobody hears either. We can't hear the words, much less get to the place where we can form sentences and words around it. Partners and couples relationships want to be right, and so often what starts out as a minor issue grows into something that is huge and for which there is no fixing. Are you hearing me? That we can start off like that with something that is little and through not listening, make that thing grow into something so monstrous that it breaks our relationship off. Listening is that important. And listening is something we have that much difficulty doing. And there's something I have also realized, that when we don't listen, we don't see. I remember my mom said, if a person will lie, the person will kill. If a person will lie, a person will steal. And I think if we will not listen, we will not see. Because even as our ears are plugged up, so are our eyes. We do not want to see what we don't want to see. We don't want to see the hurt in one's eyes. We don't want to see body language that says we give up. We don't want to see flashes of anger. We refuse to listen, and it affects our capacity to mend broken relationships by doing our part. The person trying to get a point across gets frustrated and angry and then depressed, and then they're done. They're just totally done. And one day they just wake up and say, I'm done. I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm done. You remember that song from Dreamgirls, Listen, the one that Beyonce sang? I got some of the lyrics out because I think they're so appropriate. It says, listen to the songs here in my heart, a melody I start but can't complete. Listen to the sound from deep within. It's only beginning to find release. Oh, the time has come for my dreams to be heard. They will not be pushed aside and turned into your own, all cause you won't listen. Listen, I am alone and at a crossroads. I'm not at home in my own home. And I've tried and tried to say what's on my mind. You should have known. It is a complaint that this man did not listen to this woman whom he loved, and it broke their relationship. The character played by Beyonce in that movie is a role we have all played. We have all had that that narrative with somebody in our lives. It is, and being not listened to, then it's like a dagger in your heart, especially when it's somebody that you love and you want and need for that person to listen to you. It's like a dagger in your heart. And it's a dagger also to the spirit in the relationship cannot last if there is no listening. If without listening, there can be no trust. Without trust, there's no relationship. So you see how it's all interrelated. Some people in this country have never listened to the cries for justice that come from the lips and the hearts of the least of these. Because some people have decided that other people are inhuman and less than they are, incapable of thinking or making decisions or more, they do not listen. When those people whom they disregard and disrespect cry out, people are crying all over the place. But people in power who have gotten so wealthy during this pandemic are not listening to them. Why are people still in food deserts? Why are people still getting ready to be evicted after this horrific pandemic and they lost their jobs? Why is that happening? It's because people are not listening to each other. The people in power are not interested in the lives and the needs of others. They are only concerned with their own needs. They don't listen to the poor. They blame the poor. They don't listen to the unemployed. Their thing is, if you're unemployed, it's your own fault. They have no conversation, have no idea of what it's like to have a minimum wage or below minimum wage jobs, so that you work two, three, four times. You can work two or three jobs and still not make enough money to make ends meet. They don't listen to people living in subhuman living conditions. They don't listen to mothers crying or to fathers sobbing. People choose who they will listen to, but they rarely, rarely take the time to listen to people whom they do not respect. That's why there's so little listening that goes on. They don't listen, and so they don't hear us when we say there is police brutality. They don't hear us when we say that poverty is not a choice, or hear us when we say that we make so little money that we cannot afford health care. They don't hear the sound of our voices, much less enough to make them stop and pay attention. This country is going up in flames right in front of our faces, and many people are not listening to those who have been trying to tell them for some time that America is in trouble. They don't believe our democracy is on the verge of falling. They're not studying anything to understand why that charge or that sentence is being offered. They close their eyes and ears and live in denial. If I just close my eyes, it'll be like Leave It to Beaver world. And that's not what's going to happen. They don't believe our democracy on the verge of falling. They believe that it's easier just to live in denial and act like it's not there. If I don't see it, then it's not there. That's just not real. They cannot see or care about the people, including children, all these pro-life people who, you know, will burn a building down to stop abortion. They don't see these children who are dying of COVID-19. They cannot hear the cries of hungry people, and they cannot hear the cries of human beings being attacked and assaulted by police, even while they say out loud, "I can't breathe." People hear the words of others, but they do not take the time to listen, to pay attention, so they'll know what's really going on. You can try to get someone to listen to you, and you can work at it. And I know some of you have done that, but after a while, you just give up. You just stop. And it affects every other relationship in your life. So we don't listen to each other, to the people we know, or to people who are in our lives for a reason and a season. We don't even listen to ourselves because inside of us, the divine part of us is connected to God. And sometimes that divine part is screaming at us from our insides, but we won't listen. When our consciences tell us and they're working overtime to tell us something, we tune them out. We just don't want to hear it. We want to do what we want to do in the way we want to do it. So we don't listen to each other. We don't listen to ourselves, and we don't listen to God. Get that. We don't listen to God. We just will not do it because what God wants us to do is not within the list of things that we think we ought to have to do. We challenge God in ways that's just amazing to me. We just challenge. I've done it. I've had some horrific things happen to me in my life because I challenged God, because I decided not to listen to God. I decided not to listen to that still small voice inside of me that said, that's not what you should do, or that's something that you should do. I have ignored it. We have all done it. I won't listen to God. Even now, there are times that I don't listen. Now I'm older and I've been through some stuff, so I listen a little bit more quickly than I would have before, but we don't listen to God. And God cries out all of the time. If you read the Hebrew scriptures, you see God crying out and reaching out. God created us and God gave us free will. But God has always wanted us to turn toward Him. God has always wanted us to be co-creators. God has always wanted us to walk with Him. You know, the song goes, we walk with Him, or He walks with us and talks with us and tells us that He is our own. God wants that type of relationship with us, but we won't do it. God has wanted us to listen and to do what God has told us to do all throughout the Hebrew scriptures. God has seen our conditions, has heard our cries, and knows our needs. But God has also seen how we reject her word and her will. And that has got to hurt. That has got to hurt. God has seen how we have turned our backs on God so that we would have the room to do what we've wanted to do and just thrown away justice and mercy just because we don't want to listen. The prophets in the Hebrew scriptures saw all of this. The prophets in the Hebrew scriptures, they have the heart of God, the mind of God. They feel for God. They get angry for God. And they have seen the reason they come forth and they preach their messages is because they've seen in the Hebrew scriptures, they see how we walk away from God. While we're saying God is our own, we walk away from God. These prophets walk and talk and live and breathe and think with the heart of God because. And they get sad when God tells them that we are not listening. They get sad when God tells the people that God is reaching out to and that they're not seeking Him. We're supposed to seek God so that we can live. Amos says that God says, see me and live. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. Hate evil and love good and establish justice in the gate. That's what God wants us to do. We have not wanted to move away from evil. Evil is fun sometimes. To do something you're not supposed to do, come on, talk to me with me about it. Sometimes evil just seems like it's just a little bit more exciting than to be like a good girl or a good guy, right? We have not wanted to move away from evil. Establishing justice for everyone has never been a goal of people in power. We have consistently moved away from God until something catastrophic happens. That's when we go running back to God and falling on our knees and lifting up our hands and wailing and weeping. But up to the moment of catastrophe, too many of us have just not listened to God, have not listened for God, have not reached toward God. And all of that has an effect on God, our parent. There is a space. There's a brief space where, you know, because we have for so long denied and ignored God, that there's an emptiness, just a space. And it kind of reminds me of what's happening now with people who are now trying to get a vaccine for COVID-19 and didn't do it before. And right before they've gotten intubated, they said, can I get the vaccine now? No, it's too late. There is such a thing as being too late. There is such a thing as being too late to latch on to the hand of God and to wrap yourself in the will of God. It can be too late. That's what that story was about, the five foolish virgins. They thought they had it together because they were chosen. They were part of the 10 that were chosen. They went away. They squandered their time. And when they came back, the bridegroom had come and gone. And when they went to knock on the door of the bridegroom looked through the door, didn't even open the window and said, get away from me. I do not know you. That's what we don't want. But that's what happens. There's this period of time where it's just we can't make any contact after we have ignored God for so long. So in the Hebrew scriptures, the prophets work to communicate the heart and the will and the word of God to us before it's too late. The biblical prophets worked to try to save Israel from being attacked and vanquished, first by the Assyrians and later by the Babylonians. But the people would not listen. God is heartbroken. And I don't know about you, when I read things and I see that God is heartbroken, it makes me sad because God is almighty and all powerful. How can such a mighty deity be heartbroken? But if the Hebrew scriptures are to be internalized and ingested and digested, we see that God gets sad. He gets sad and he's heartbroken because God knows that we cannot do life without reaching out to and holding on to God. God watches us and just takes a deep breath and says to herself, this is not going to work for you. This is not going to turn out well. You need to hold on to my unchanging hand, but we don't do it. And it makes God sad. Amos reminds the Israelites that God is watching. Amos reminds the people that evil steals our joy. Amos reminds the people that God is watching, and he says in the scripture that God says, I gave you cleanness of teeth in all your cities and lack of bread in all your places, yet you did not return to me. I've been trying to reach you. I've been doing all kinds of things to get you to turn to me. I gave you that. Also, I withheld from you the rain from you. I would send no rain upon one city and send no rain upon another city. Yet you did not return to me. He keeps repeating that phrase. Yet you did not return to me. I smote you with blight and mildew, your fig trees and your olive trees, the locust devoured. Yet you did not return to me. He goes on and says, I sent you a pestilence after the manner of Egypt. I slew your young men with the sword, and yet you did not return to me. How incredibly selfish and belligerent are we? I overthrew some of you as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, and you were as a brand plucked out of the burning, and yet you did not return to me. Therefore, with God, if you don't listen to God, there is a therefore. There are consequences to not listening to God. And he says it, Amos says it for God in this chapter of Amos. Therefore, and I'm pausing here because the question we're examining is, what do you do when nobody will listen to you? So you, as a human being, you might pout, you might end a relationship, you might get divorced, you might take a trip, you might change your whole way of life and your goals. But after a while, when you're not listened to, you do something. What does God do? God says, God makes you have a face-to-face with God. Therefore, that's a very important word. Therefore, God says, I will do to you, O Israel, because I will do this to you. Prepare to meet your God. Prepare to meet your God. That's not something you want to hear from God. That's not something that you want to hear from God. For lo, he who forms the mountains and creates the wind and declares to man what is his thought, who makes the morning darkness and treads on the heights of the earth, the Lord, the God of hosts, is his name. Amos the prophet tells the Israelites that because they have not listened to God, that God will meet them where they are and that it will not be fun. It will not be a good thing. The word used for prepare in the scripture means to prepare for disaster, and the people know it. The people know that the word that Amos used in communicating this, these words from God, he used that word prepare, and they absolutely knew what that meant. It was going to be really, really rough for them. They would have known what Amos is talking about, and Amos, even now, is trying to say to them, you got some time. We're not in that little blank time where it's too late. Not yet. You're close. You have some time. I'm delivering you this message from God because you still have some time. But if you don't, there will be a therefore. If you don't listen to God, there will be a therefore, and it will not be fun. So what does it mean? What does it look like when we ignore God and don't listen to God and experience a divine encounter, a situation that's so powerful that we know it is none but God? God shows up. God shows up and gets our attention when we have refused to listen, and God shakes us. I don't know if you have ever been shaken by God, but oh my goodness, when God shakes you metaphorically, you know that you have been shaken. God shakes us and God leads us. Watch this. God leads us beside the still waters. Let's us see what life is and can be if we listen to God. He leads us beside the still waters and he restores our soul. We don't listen to God, and God lets us see what we are missing. God lets us see how our situations might have been different had we listened to her. When we don't listen to God, God does what God needs to do to get our attention, just like we work to get people to listen to us. So we have to make a decision. We have to make a decision to listen to God, and we have to make a decision to listen to people that we don't want to listen to. And we have to make a decision about moving away from people who never listen to us. If someone's in your life and he or she never listens to you, that's a clear-cut sign that that person is not right for you. And you need not hold on to someone who is not right for you. You need not do it. God has a therefore. We ought to have a therefore too. Therefore, I have tried and tried and tried to talk with you. I have tried and tried to explain, but you will not listen. Therefore, I'm dropping the mic. Therefore, peace out. We have to make some decisions when we're not being listened to, because all people need to be listened to, and God needs to be listened to. So how do we do that? Here's the thing that we have to pray. We have to pray to God for a couple of things. One, to get the strength to back away from people who will not listen to us. Back away, back away. Save your soul, protect your soul, and get into a different type of relationship with God. We have to pray for the strength. How many of us stay with people that are not good for us or to us and who never listen to us? We need to identify who those people are in our lives and move away from them, but we will only be able to have the strength to do it if we pray to God. The second thing we have to do is make sure we're listening to God. It would be kind of selfish, wouldn't it, if we were moving away from somebody who's making our lives miserable while we're making God's life miserable by not listening to God. We have to make sure that we have it both right on both ends. We don't want to be ignored, and God doesn't want to be ignored. We have to pray and ask God to give us the strength and the desire to walk toward her. We have to be in relationships so that we can have what I call salvific conversations, conversations that will help us grow in God and be willing to follow God's commands to us. It's not fun to be ignored. It's not fun for us as human beings. It's not fun for God, and it's not right. And as I'm thinking about this, and I'm going back to Beyonce's song, Listen. Incline your ear toward God. Love God enough to want to keep from insulting God. Truly, God, trust God enough to believe that whatever it is that God is telling you to do will be worth it. Respect God enough to put your hand in the hand of God and follow God's direction. And if we do that, God will do what God does. God will turn our mourning into dancing. God won't take away our difficult times, but God will equip us to handle them. God will help us to stand. God will help us to survive whatever it is that we are experiencing. And God will be there for and with us so that we will be able to feel God's presence. But we must make the decision to listen to God. So I just want to leave you with those two things. If someone is not listening to you, back away from that person. Get that person out of your space. And if you're not listening to God, turn toward God. Turn toward God. Move toward God. Do whatever you need to do. Pray whatever you need to pray in order to feel your connection with God. Please do that. Listen to God, because God does not want to be ignored. And I just want to end with a story. I think about this story often because it was so meaningful to me. Years ago in my congregation, there was a young girl, very young girl. I think she was 12 years old, and she had cancer. She was really, really sick. She had a wonderful, wonderful spirit, but that cancer was eating her up. It was just eating her alive. And so it had come to the point where doctors knew that there wasn't going to be anything else that they could do for her. And she was in Children's Hospital here in Columbus, Ohio, and her parents were there and I was there. And then I had to leave and go out of town. So I left, but kept a report from the parents on what was going on. So anyway, while I was there, I can remember as we were standing around the bed, doctors coming in and, you know, doing their pronouncements. But the dad, who was so, so, so close to God, said, "No, I hear God telling me it's going to be all right." He didn't say what all right meant. He didn't say, "I heard God saying that my daughter's going to get up and walk out of here." He said, "I heard God say that it will be all right." God was talking to this man because his God was not ignoring him. Concurrently, what was going on as the father talked to the doctor was not hearing what the father was saying in terms of what he knew was what his daughter was going through, kind of what she needed. He was not hearing. So it was very interesting. The man is listening to God, but the doctor is not listening to the man. It was very interesting. And I just watched it. Well, a couple of days after that, the doctor, who would not listen to the father, was in the room. And this particular morning, that little girl just finally took her last breath. And when she took her last breath, the brightest sun streamed into that room. It was none but a miracle. It was so profound. It was like the little girl had the sun by the hand and said, "Come on in here and be with my daddy, because I'm getting ready to go see Jesus, but I want you to come on in here." As soon as she took her last breath, that sun just lit up that room. It was like nothing I have ever seen before. The father looked and he smiled. The doctor looked and he cried. And he said, "I had no idea I had no idea that you were so close to God. I had no idea. And he kept saying that. I had no idea, no idea. And he walked out of the room sobbing. This is what we do. This is what we can do. This is what we must do. We listen to God and let God be our God all by itself. Let's listen to the song. We don't have to worry because God is in our hands. Let's work. Listen.
Going through, lift your hands and stand with me.
So we put our life in God's hands. We don't want to continue to ignore God. We want to listen to God and trust God enough to do what God tells us to do or tells us not to do. We don't want to be ignored. Neither does God. And then if we are in a relationship with God and we put God first, we won't worry so much when we are trying to get through some things and we know God's telling us something to do or not to do, and we don't want to do it. It will be a whole lot easier. We listen to God. God listens to us, and that's how we grow. So I hope that this message does something for you. Go back and read Amos and see how many times God says, "Yet you did not return to me," and let us work to make our testimony. Yeah, I did return to you. I came back to you. I left, but I came back. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, we now say thank you for this opportunity to have sat with you. And I ask God that we think about deeply what it is we must think about and in the ways we must think about it so that we can be as close to you as possible. We need you now like never before. So many things are going on. Nothing is normal as we've all known it. And so if we don't have you, God, we're like bolts without an anchor, and we need to be anchored. And so come by here, Lord God, whoever is on this call who needs a special prayer right now, in the name of Jesus, touch them, wrap your arms around them so that they can feel your presence. And then, oh Lord God, help us all as we get away from our posture of prayer. Help us to say, my life is in your hands. My life will be in your hands because you, God, are worthy of all the praise. I ask you to hear this prayer in the name of Jesus. Let the people of God say amen. That's it for us this week. I hope that you have a wonderful week and be good. Get your vaccination and we'll see you next week. Take good care. Bye-bye.
Thank you for worshiping here with us today, Crazy Faith. As always, we hope that something in sermon or in song gave you food for thought or it ministered to you in some way. And please let us know if there are any prayer requests so that we can pray for you this week. We want to help be some prayer warriors for you and your journey. Our mission here at CFM is providing direct service to marginalized communities and doing justice work in the constant fight against injustice. We are collecting socks for the homeless, and our goal for 2021 is 2,400 pairs of socks, and we are steadily on our way to reaching this goal. If you want to help us in this endeavor, you can give us a donation by going to our sock web store at the link in the description box below, or email us at crazyfaith2019@gmail.com to send us a donation of socks directly. Thank you in advance for any support. Join us tomorrow, Monday, August 6th at 6:30 p.m. on Zoom. We have been studying the Hebrew scriptures and Bible study, so parts of the Bible that people often don't like to read, but very important to be knowledgeable about. So please feel free to invite anyone that may want to study the Bible and also just do so in a really fun way. Hope to see everyone tomorrow. If you want to help us in our outreach efforts, you can donate through our website or through Venmo or through Cash App. Our Venmo is at crazy-faith. Our Cash App is RedZip. And our website is crazyfaithministries.org. For those who are not on Facebook but want to see a playback of our service, you can go to our church online platform, which is at crazyfaithministries.online.church. You can also visit our YouTube channel. Our services are also posted on there. The link is in the description box below. So thank you for being with us. Go out and have a wonderful week. We hope that you continue to embody our motto and that we have come to worship and we leave to serve. Thanks, y'all. Have a great week. Bye.